It was early 2009 and our daughter Janelle was diagnosed with breast cancer. And she had prayed to the Lord and he just basically let her know that she was going to be okay. She was totally at peace. But about 2 weeks into that diagnosis, I had this rock in my stomach that I went to bed with and I woke up with, and she was going to start her chemo sessions. And I needed to be there for her, and so I sat quietly in my living room and I just prayed to God. And he knew what was going on, and I needed to be there as a whole person without this fear that I had. And so I prayed for a while, and then I just sat quietly, and it was like this hand just kind of came over me, and I just had peace, and I never had to go back during her 10 months of treatment to ask for that peace again. It was an awesome experience.
I think my most traumatic turmoil was 14 years into our marriage. We've been married 54 years. And I had a pretty good problem with alcohol, and she reached her breaking point and we separated, and I was living by myself in an old trailer with no heat, and I got to the point where I just felt that there was nothing left, and I had a gun in my hand and I was gonna just take care of it, end it all. And for some reason, I took one more drink and I passed out. And when I woke in the morning, I still had the gun in my hand. But then something came over me and said, there's got to be more than this. And that's when the first time I realized that God had intervened in my life. But it took me another almost 30 years for me to accept him as my savior and realize that God was my savior. And after that, I started looking back on my life, and it's been quite a while, and I can see the points in my life where God has intervened and put his hand on my shoulder and saved me. And now I'm at complete peace with he has rewarded us so much with our family, with each other, with our lives. We're in a position now where I just wished everybody could feel the peace and the security that we have just by realizing that Christ is our Savior and he's going to take care of us.
That's sweet. Everybody needs something in life they can count on. Everybody does. Things that you can rely on, things that you can look forward to that you know are going to be steady and there and present and available. Everybody needs that. Humans share this kind of a thing. Something else we share is the need for peace. Peace in our heart and our soul, peace in our life. We're in a series called Promises. And a promise is very, very important. That word itself separates it out from suggestions, possibilities, probabilities. Because when we have a promise, we have a legitimate reason to expect that which is promised. We should expect it, and we can claim it. Jesus promised peace to us. And he told us to not be afraid. We need to treat his promise as a binding declaration that he intends to fulfill, and then our commitment is to live it out. So, peace is one of the deepest longings of the human heart. I believe that my whole life. We all need it and pursue it, whether we call it peace or something else. I've been a counselor for 36 plus years. I began counseling with the Navajo and Hopi tribes in an alcoholism center. I worked in clinical mental health, private practice, and now I do pastoral counseling. But there's a thread running through all of this. People, no matter what their issues were, wanted peace, meaning they wanted to be at rest. inside. Whether it's financial struggles, whether it's a marital issue, whether it's parenting issues, whether it's a health problem, whether it's an issue with your in your neighborhood, in your work commitments and relationships, and whatever it is. But underneath it all, I've always known what people wanted because it's what I've always wanted, to be at rest inside in spite of what's going on. And we're going to make that case today through looking at the words of Jesus. And it's really important because he sets it apart. And see, God's plan all along has been somehow to help us have peace. It was part of an ancient blessing. In the book of Numbers, one of the books of the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, we read this, Numbers 6, verses 24 through 26. And this is more one of the more commonly known verses. Here's what's said. Tell Aaron and his sons, this is how you are to bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. This became part of the church early on. It's still part of the practices in many mainline churches. Maybe some of you have been at a church where what's commonly done in a service is, peace be with you, and you would say what? And also with you. Why peace? Why that word? Why not, hey, be happy today. Hey, you too. Or hey, have some chuckles today, okay? Yeah, I'm chuckling right now. It was peace. Peace. It's always been the human need. There's always been a longing in the human soul for peace. So we're going to look at what peace is. We're going to consider some definitions. I'm going to date myself because I am a refugee of the troubled 60s. Any other refugees here willing to raise your hands? Preach it, speak it. We're in a choir together. What do we mean by peace? Consider some definitions. Here's one definition. No, the symbol of peace. There you go. Peace. You remember that? I mean, that took me back. Man. But we have other definitions we're going to walk through right now. These definitions are about when we sit here and think of the word peace, or people in general think of the word peace, we're going to start with freedom from disturbance, quiet and tranquility, personal peace. I have no disturbances in my life right now. I feel at peace within. It's a blessing. I'm really enjoying it. I want it all the time, kind of a thing. Then we have freedom from war and fighting, global peace. There are initiatives and groups and movements all around the world and have been for centuries to move towards global peace. And some might say, you know, we're closer now than ever. Some might say that. But at the risk of being somewhat cynical, I did some digging into this concept of global peace. And want to share with you what I found, and it was actually stunning to me. In the last 5,600 years up to this moment, there have been only, at the most, 292 years of peace. And those aren't 292 years crammed together. They're spread out. Some say only 268. There's been 14,351 wars and still counting. Some might say, well, it's better now. Research says otherwise. The last 110 years have been the most murderous years in the history of this planet. Estimates are of 190 million killed. And if you look at 2013, the start of the World War I, 190 million would have been 10% of the population of the world at that time. With all these wars, what else can we learn? Well, we had 1,656 arms races. What is an arms race? You might wonder about that, an arms race. That's where two countries or more are competing with one another in their spending and their building of military power. In all of these arms races, only 16 didn't end in war. Only 16. There's been over 8,000 plus peace treaties in this time, 5,600 years. 99.9% were broken, and the few remaining ones that weren't broken, one or the other countries involved collapsed economically. The total price paid for all these wars in this time, over 3.7 billion people, just for the wars. 3.7 billion. Then we look at the last 110 years. We cannot make a case right now that we're any close to peace in the world than we've ever been. It simply defies description to say that. So what does Jesus tell us? Well, we have a third definition. So we have global peace, personal peace, and then there's a third peace. It's relational peace. A third definition is a state of mutual harmony and of serenity. Then Jesus makes this statement in the book of John. Chapter 14. Chapter 14 and the chapters after are what's called the farewell discourse. He's preparing his followers for his physical departure. Meaning, he knows he's going to die and rise again. They don't. But he's telling them, I got to go. What I came here to do has been done. But he loves these guys and he's trying to help them. So he says in John 14, verse 27, he says, peace I leave with you. I leave with you. Peace, my peace, possessive. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. We're going to be even more clear about that as we walk through this. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. We have some say-so over how much fear and trouble we allow into our life. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. So I want to break this verse down because there's parts to it that we have to understand to fully grasp what Jesus is giving to his followers and now to us today. So first is peace of the world, and then my peace, the peace of Christ. And the peace of the world, here's what we're looking at. It's literally a break from stress. It's accomplishing something we set out to do. It's relief of pain. It's all those kinds of things. These things are transient. They're unstable. Transient, they move around. They're unstable, and they're short-lived. So what's called peace, as the world gives, is literally temporary relief and respite from stress, pain, and suffering. Temporary. Anybody who's lived a little bit knows what we've said many times up here. You've either just come through some trials, you're in some trials now, or you're headed for some trials. History tells us that. Regardless of civilization, that's true. So we've come to call peace. I'll have peace finally when the plumbing works, the light bill's paid, I've recovered from the cold, my Aunt Susie's tumor's benign, we finally got enough to pay off the car, on and on and on and on, and we call it peace. It's not peace at all. It's not the peace Jesus is talking about. Jesus' peace is enduring, deep, restful, and calming. It's far more than the absence of problems. It's eternal. And it's stable, and it's Holy Spirit powered. Whether you know it or not this morning, when you walked in here, you either believe that or you don't. Many don't. And I understand. I mean, I've gone through a ton of junk in my life. I understand that. But it is my sincere prayer that when you walk out, you'll believe it. You will believe it. This beautiful gift he's given to us. That you would believe it in the morning, that you would understand throughout the day, it's been given to you through Jesus by a Father who loves you. So the peace of Jesus is not the peace of the world. It's just not. So when we look at the peace of Jesus, then we can also look at parts of that, facets to the peace of Jesus. And if you got your bulletins, we have some fill-in words for you right here. And I want you, as I walk through these, maybe even close your eyes and imagine, what would it be like if I had this in my life? The peace of Jesus. First of all, it's peace within. Peace emotionally. Peace mentally. Peace spiritually. Peace within. The peace of Jesus within. And peace with God. I'm not at odds with him. We don't have enmity between us. I'm not angry and confused with him. I'm walking with him. We're together throughout the day. I talk with him. He talks with me. I share. I have peace with him. Peace with others. Peace with others. Now, I'm not in charge of others. I'm barely in charge of me. And that's a little shaky. But if I have the peace within, and I want to have peace with my friend Rick, I can't make him be at peace inside. But here's the key. Even if we weren't at peace in the relationship, I can still be at peace inside. I can have peace with others even if they're not cool with me. Because if I couldn't, then we're back to peace the world gives again, aren't we? We're right back there again. And it wouldn't make any sense at all that it's different. So what does Jesus mean when he says, I'm not giving to you as the world gives? And who is he talking to, and why, and what's the situation? We really need to know this situation. Remember, it's the farewell discourse. He's going to be crucified within hours of this statement. And he's already told them, I'm going to rise again. I'm the one. They don't get any of it. Imagine, if you will, these guys being with Jesus for right around 3 years, through thick and thin, great trouble, long, arduous journeys walking, and watching him do miracles and watching him confound the authorities with teaching that the Bible calls astounding and amazing. They were stunned. His ability to flummox the Jewish leaders and just make them speechless. Every scrape they were in, he got them through. Every next place they needed to go, he guided them. As a guy, even as they watched the miracles, as just a man who was with them. And, you know, John, two places John says, much more occurred than was written down, but there's no room for it. If you think about it, just 1 month of the travels of the disciples with Jesus, talking all day long as they walked and did things, is probably more than 20 of these Bibles could record. Just 1 month. This is the Jesus they knew. And he's telling them, I got to go. Now, he's told them why. They don't get the why. I wouldn't get the why. So you're going? We gave up everything. We followed you. You're leaving. You're our security blanket. You're going? You're leaving? They don't get the resurrection yet. They just don't. But he loves them, and he knows they don't. He knows what they need. The answers to why he would give him this gift and now are found in John 13, earlier in John 14. What is he really giving them when he says, peace I leave with you? That's the kind of language, really, that we use when we're going to go permanently, isn't it? Think about this. It would be amazing to live with this peace, wouldn't it? Think what he's saying to them. I wrote this because I'm thinking it's kind of a bequeathing thing. You know, like he's bequeathing something to them, like I might bequeath to my family if it was my time. Dear son, I give you my Marvel comics from the 60s. They're all in these two boxes. Dear son-in-law, you can have my spear guns. They've done great work for us. You know, I might bequeath things. What if he was bequeathing? What if it sounded like this? I bequeath to you tranquility of soul, uninterrupted happiness, and joy of mind, everlasting friendship with God. All of this is my gift to you as I prepare to leave, because this is what he's doing. But it doesn't end there. It's not just what he's giving to them. It's also who is being sent to them. He knows they don't get it. You see, here's the reality. Jesus, everywhere he went, people gathered and either to listen or get angry or something, but they gathered. What if he stayed? And he commissioned the disciples to go therefore, you know, to all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, making disciples, teaching them. But Jesus was still preaching. Where's everybody going to go? I mean, Peter's all right, but Jesus is featured over here today. So I'm going to go hang out with Jesus. His range might be about 100 yards. He did what he came to do. It's done. Now it's their job to go. And he knows they don't fully get it yet. and he's leaving, and he can see the fear and the pain and the anguish on their faces. He says in John 14, verses 25 and 26, he tells them this: "All this I have spoken while still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, in other places called the Comforter, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you." What we learned there is the Holy Spirit is coming, and by now has come, and lives within all of us. And the Holy Spirit's going to teach. And it wasn't just going to teach you for a week before you go out. Teach right up to this moment in time in the heart of every believer. The Holy Spirit will teach. But Jesus also says, "And to remind you of what I said." We all probably instinctively know we're creatures who need to be reminded. We need to be reminded. We have to focus on and completely redo, retrain those things that are most important to us to remain competent and have excellence at them. That's the human dilemma. We need to be reminded. So Jesus is telling him, "And to be reminded of what I said to you," in these verses. So the Holy Spirit will teach us all things, and the Holy Spirit will remind us of what Jesus said. The Holy Spirit keeps us right in how we live and reminds us regularly of the most important things that have ever been said to us. And now we have those things said to us through the Holy Word of God, Scripture. So what does it mean for me? Do I have the full and thorough, complete and deep reach of peace in my life the moment I accept Christ? Well, yes, the gift has been given, but think about a gift. I mean, I was given a cell phone years ago. Out of all the things a cell phone can do, I can do about four. It's on a good day. Yet my wife can do probably hundreds. And there's other people that can do everything on that cell phone. So the phone's in my hand, it can only do what I, in partnership, learn to do with it to make it useful. But it's still sitting there, has everything. The gift of peace has been given to the believer. But I have a role that I play in this gift of peace if what Jesus said about I'm always forgetting stuff is true. I need reminders. I need a practice that renews and refreshes everything I've already been told. So we can find some guidance in this starting in the Old Testament on what this might be, my partnership in embracing and living out the gift of peace that's not as the world gives. We find in Isaiah, trust. These perfect words for trust. You will keep, here it is, in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you. Trust in the Lord forever. For the Lord himself is the rock eternal. Psychologists would tell you, licensed counselors like myself would tell you, trust is the foundation of any and all healthy relationships. Trust, 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 trust. And here we read in ancient words of wisdom straight from our Father, trust me, trust me. We're going to be limited in how much we can trust anyone in this world. We can trust somebody 99.8%, but I don't always know when I send them to the store for tortillas, they're going to come back with tortillas. They might come back with laundry soap on sale. I mean, trust. But we trust the Father with everything. We trust him. And we read in Psalm 119, another step that's in our partnership in this. Great peace have those who love your law, and nothing can make them stumble. Today, I would say, by law, we're talking about this entire Bible. The law is in there, as they were referencing in Psalms. I would say the entire Bible. And what does it say here? It says, love your law and nothing can make them stumble. I have a way that I can grow in my love for God's holy word. Spending time with it, digging in, reading, and then studying. I can grow in this and learn to love his law. And the more I do, the less I stumble. And then we have choices about where we set our heart, what we set our heart upon. You know, what's closest to our heart? Timothy Keller puts it this way: Christian peace is not the absence of troubles. It is a peace that is unshakable, even in the midst of troubles. During difficult times, Christians are called to remember the living God who works out all things for good for those who love him. If we set our hearts on anything else besides God, we can lose our peace. That's just how it happens. But if our greatest love is the unchanging God, then our peace can never be taken from us. Taken from us. Two special gifts referenced in Scripture. At one point, Jesus gives people joy. He says, my joy, I give you my joy. This is my peace I give you. So apparently, the deepest, richest, most profound joy and peace I can ever experience can't come to me through this world. It just can't. It could be a little frustrating. I wish it could. But you know what the other side of that coin is? The world cannot take it away from me because it cannot give it to me. It just can't. Just can't. Sometimes the Apostle Paul's words in Philippians are the ones used to talk about peace, and he says there's peace that beyond all comprehension. He says the God of peace will be with you. One of the most tortured people in written recorded history, who lived through unspeakable torture and horrors. And what's he saying from prison? I may do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And he references the peace that he has. Well, guess what? He didn't give it to himself. How did the peace come that Paul could use? Paul comes after John 14:27. Jesus said, my peace I give you. The peace Paul experienced in Philippians was that peace that Jesus gave him. So we know it's real. We know it. So then we also think a lot about expectations. Expectations, guys, expectations. We have expectations. If we expect the world to give us peace, we're going to be sorely disappointed. If we think that, if we have been under stress for a long period of time waiting for this one thing to happen, and I just know when it happens, and I'll finally be at peace. Most of us have been there, whatever that thing was, and then it happens, and we're at peace. Then days later, weeks later, something came up. It's like, where's that peace? Expectations. A pastor taught about this years ago. I like the way he says it. About expectation. He says, if before I lead you into a room, I tell you it's a honeymoon suite, you might walk in that room and go, this place is a dump. That honeymoon. But if I walked into the very same room and told you it's a jail cell, you might say, wow, that's plush for a jail cell. If I ever get caught, that's where I want to be. The room hasn't changed. The room hasn't changed. The world is not going to change. You're not going to start fixing problems and get that deep, rich peace because that would be apart from God. I want you to look a little more at what Pat and Jerry share. And you guys, remember the Sunday I was in here and I was chatting and greeting and I talked to you guys. And it just came up somehow that I was going to preach on peace. And you mentioned, we have peace. And I went, oh, a God moment. And we talked. And you came in. Watch what they shared on the screens.
There's so much more peace now, knowing what we've been through and where the Lord has touched us. We have so much more peace now than
About the material. Not about what you have. It's not about where you live. It's not about any of those things. It's just knowing that you have a Heavenly Father who loves you and is always with you no matter what, till the day you die, and then you go to heaven and you're with him for eternity. It's just an amazing feeling. It's a different kind of peace. It's just calming, and it doesn't go away, even when times do get tough.
I don't know how I could explain it any better, that God has given us everything we've got, and he's given us a real, real sense of of peace and acceptance and thankfulness.
Yes, very grateful.
Beautiful. So in the peace that Jesus is bequeathing to his disciples, he knows, and they've already tasted what their life's going to be like. There's going to be the glory and joy of seeing people come to Jesus. There's going to be horror visited on them. 10 of the disciples die in martyrdom, gruesome martyrdom. So we cannot think that this peace is only when everything's at rest. It was never at rest for them. That's why he was telling them the peace is deeper, deeper. You have to get this because I know what you're going to face out there. And I love you so much, I want you to have this. So from those two verses we looked at, a quote from Timothy Keller and the video that we just saw, we can learn more about our role in keeping this fresh in us. If you got a pencil, we got some more fill-ins for you for the bulletin. First of all, we have to trust the Lord himself. The Lord himself, the rock eternal. Trust. Trust is a choice we can make. We have to read, study, learn, and grow to love the Bible, God's word. This is his holy word given to people to write for us to use every second of our lives till we're with him until he returns. And we're called to remember, and if you're a fan of kind of developing that theme at all, you can go to the first chapter of 2 Peter and hear more about how Peter says, remember what you already know and are firmly grounded in. I'm going to remind you, remind you, remind you. And then we must pray continually and draw close to Jesus. He's our friend. Continue. That's the fellowship, the relationship. We can hold on to this promise. We're the body of Christ, the church, not the building, but the church. And in the church, what you should find, and it's our heart's desire that you find it here, guidance and support and encouragement and opportunities for group and fellowship. We have Sunday gathering. You're in one right now. It's happening all over the world. We have Bible study and growth groups here to help with feeding on God's word, to help with building fellowship. And we have serving and fellowship. And I would actually put those two together. One of the reasons I come through the kitchen on Sunday mornings, almost always, is I love just to be with those people who are happily chatting and singing and saying stuff. And, oh, I saw this movie. Really, what was in it? And these people have been together for years, cutting bagels and scooping fruit. Beautiful service, but there's so much more that happens. It's fellowship, community, relationship. And it's all right here. I want this for you so much more than I can say. We want it for you. I want it for myself. I want it for my family and friends. But you know, most important, God wants it for you. You're built for this. When you draw close to him, God's word tells us so. I really like the words of Jonathan Edwards, great theologian, preacher, teacher of the 1700s. The way he put it struck me. The foundation of the Christian's peace is everlasting. It is what no time, no change can destroy. It will remain when the body dies. It will remain when the mountains depart and the hills shall be rolled together as a scroll. The foundation of his comfort shall never be diminished, and the stream shall never be dried. His comfort and joy is a living spring in the soul, a well of water springing up to everlasting life. Let's pray. Father, we're thirsty for this water. We're hungry for you, thirsty for this gift. Jesus, if we know you, your word tells us the gift's been given through the Holy Spirit who dwells within. There may be some here who don't yet know you, Father. I'm just so glad they're here. They are so welcome here. Maybe now is the time that you're speaking to them. Maybe now's the time where they say, I need this peace. I need you. I need more. There's got to be something else, as we learned in the video this morning. There's got to be more. Speak in those hearts. Make the timing right for you and move them to you, Jesus. But Lord, we all want peace. It's not perfect. We don't get it perfectly, but help us grow in it. Help us get stronger in it. Help us have more of it day by day, Lord God. We thank you that it's a gift, so we don't have to worry about earning it or being worthy. All we do is accept you. for who you are, Jesus. We thank you for this. And pray this in your precious name. Amen.